The ASUS Zephyrus Duo 15 has a design focused around improving thermals, so let's see just how hot it gets with this high-end hardware inside. I've got the highest specs available, so we should be looking at a worst case in terms of temperatures here. Air comes in through the large vents underneath, as well as through the vents which are placed behind the bottom screen. The lower screen opens up when you open the lid of the machine, and this unique feature is key for pulling in more cool air. The bottom feet seem to raise the back up a little higher compared to most others I've tested, which should also help with airflow. Air is then exhausted from the vents on the left and right sides, and from the vents on the back. There are a couple of fans inside with heat pipes shared between the CPU and GPU, and ASUS are using liquid metal on the CPU in this model. The Armory Crate software lets you select between different performance modes, which from lowest to highest are silent, performance, and turbo modes. However, there is also manual mode, which is required if you want to set the fans to maximum speed, and it also applies a GPU overclock too. Anytime I've tested in manual mode, I'm using full fan speed, but this is also where you would customize the fans. By default, there was no undervolting applied, the opposite in fact. I actually found a positive value applied. As I've got an unlocked K processor here, I can undervolt. However, I'm not sure if this is the case with the i7 model. Although the RTX 2080 Super is max-Q, it's using Nvidia's new dynamic boost, which means the power limit can boost higher depending on if there is power available. Thermals were tested with a 21 degrees Celsius ambient room temperature. Idle results down the bottom were okay. Worst case stress tests were done with the Ada 64 CPU stress test with CPU only checked, and the Heaven benchmark at max settings at the same time. While gaming was tested with Watch Dogs 2, as I find it to use a good combination of processor and graphics. Overall, the temperatures were quite impressive, even under these heavy loads. I was only seeing thermal throttling on the CPU at 95 degrees if I manually boost the power limit in Intel XTU, so this is not default behavior. In the default modes, turbo mode runs a bit warmer than the lower silent and performance modes, while manual mode cools a bit further, as manual lets you set fan speed higher, and I tested manual with max fans. These are the average clock speeds while running the same tests. The GPU in the green bars saw a bit of a boost in manual mode due to the overclock, but it's not that big of a change. Prior to making any manual changes in turbo or manual modes, the CPU was able to average 3.7 GHz across all 8 cores. This is an okay result, but with some simple tweaks, we're able to boost this right up to 4.4 GHz, which is a much more impressive result in these heavy combined CPU plus GPU workloads. Most of the gains seem to be due to the processor power limit being capped to 45 watts in the highest turbo or manual modes. This would be part of why the temperatures were looking good. However, we do at least have the option of manually increasing the limit, right up until thermals become the next limitation. For the GPU, in performance mode it seemed to have an 80 watt cap, and although higher modes appear to limit it to 90 watts, we were actually starting to see it boost a bit higher in this game. This is still a CPU intensive game though. In more GPU heavy tasks, the GPU could run more consistently closer to 100 watts. So it just depends on the game slash workload. When we look at how an actual game performs with these different options, there's not that much gain by applying all the tweaks. Silent mode was still giving a decent frame rate, so you can get away with playing on a quieter system if you don't want loud fan noise. If you want to see more gaming benchmarks from the Duo 15, check the card in the top right or link in the description where I've tested 21 games at all setting levels. In a CPU-only stress test with the GPU now idle, we're able to reach much higher power levels on the processor. If you recall, with the GPU active, the CPU would not pass 45 watts prior to manual user intervention. Now, in a CPU-only load, this 45 watt limit is only seen at silent, with turbo doubling it to 90, which is great to see, as many other laptops just arbitrarily cap it lower regardless of workload being run. This results in fair performance for an 8-core processor at stock in turbo mode, and manual mode with the fans going faster doesn't really change this, as both were hitting the 90 watt PL1 limitation, though with some simple tweaks, it's possible to get extra performance. Of course, if we make these changes, we reach the 95 degree thermal limit. I've used Cinebench to show you how these different modes perform. Single core performance was unaffected regardless of the mode in use, and the multi-core score was decent. When we compare it against others, it's the best 10980HK result I've recorded so far, though it is still getting beaten by the far cheaper RP15 with Ryzen 7 4800H. As for the external temperatures where you'll actually be putting your hands, at idle in silent mode, the keyboard was around the usual 30 degrees. degrees I typically see. With the stress tests going, it warms up to around the mid 40s and felt warm but not hot. Performance mode was similar. Turbo mode was also pretty similar. Then manual mode with the fans at maximum was a touch cooler. The screen above the keyboard didn't seem to heat up as there's a large gap between it and the rest of the machine. Plus there are air intakes behind it. Let's have a listen to fan noise next. At idle, the fans were only just audible. With the stress tests going in silent mode, it's still on the quieter side. Performance mode was still quieter than most other gaming laptops. Turbo mode was closer to average, while max speed was starting to get loud. You'd probably want headphones. I think this is good though. It's far better to have some user control over the fan speed and pick the mode that you want to use instead of being stuck one way or the other. And as we saw, gaming while running quieter at the expense of some performance is possible should your preference be towards system volume rather than performance. In silent mode with the quieter fans though, the bottom of the machine did actually feel quite hot to the touch towards the back. So you definitely want to keep it on a desk and not in your lap in that scenario. Overall, the temperatures at stock look good with the Zephyrus Duo 15. However, this seems to mostly be due to the 45-watt cap on the processor when a combined CPU and GPU workload is running. You do have the option of manually raising this if you want more performance. But for GPU-heavy games, the 45-watt limit doesn't seem too bad, as outlined in my earlier video where I tested 21 different games. It's always going to be a trade-off between thermals and performance, and the fact you're given the option to make that choice is a positive. The unique design seems to do well in helping cooling. Pulling air in below the second screen results in there being a large space for airflow. Plus the liquid metal on the CPU should be assisting too. Undervolting is possible in the unlocked HK model I've got, and if you want to use a cooling pad, then that can further help improve thermals too. Just don't expect a performance gain unless you boost the power levels, as thermals aren't really a limitation until you mod it. Let me know what you thought about the thermals from the ASUS Zephyrus Duo 15 gaming laptop down in the comments. And if you're new to the channel, you'll definitely want to get subscribed for the upcoming full review to see everything this dual screen machine is capable of.